Atlanta from June 2004 to June 2010, the Scotts Hill Church of Christ in Scotts Hill, Tennessee. And since August 2016 at the Estes Church of Christ in Henderson, Tennessee. In July 2010, he began serving as associate professor in Bible at Free Hardeman. In 2012, Dr. Burleson completed a PhD in New Testament and Greek at the New Orleans Theological Seminary, working in the area of New Testament textual criticism. He is a graduate of Free Hardeman, has a master's degree from Free Hardeman University, 2001, Lipscomb, 2003, New Orleans Theological Seminary, 2007. In 2015, Dr. Burleson also began directing the annual Bible lectureship at Free Hardeman. Dr. Burleson, incidentally, I remember going to that about 5 years ago, my first one. And when I went there, I thought, I've got to get a degree from this university somehow or another. And so I paid, a lot of it. So. Dr. Burleson is married to Christy Johnson Burleson. They have 4 children. Eden, 10, Canaan, 7, Jordan, 4, and Haven, 8 months. He has written a book titled Once Delivered, Forever Established on the story of how we got the Bible that is coming out in September. And I really want to read this from the Warren Christian Apologetics Center. So we really appreciate you coming up here, down here, I guess, and teaching this class. And as a personal experience, I've had Dr. Burleson for 2 classes, and that's why I wanted to bring him here, because he has a lot of knowledge that can help. Specialty, and I put some bio information in your folder, is the textual criticism, which I think is very, very beneficial for us. Before we get started, Rick, can you lead us in a prayer?
Be happy to. Let's all bow together. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful unto Thee for this occasion that brings us together to study more of Thy Word. Father, we pray Thy blessings upon our teacher tonight, that he will have studied his lesson in a way that will do the most benefit to us as students. We pray for us as students of Thy Word, Father, that we'll take everything that he says and search them out of the searchlight of Thy Word, prove whether or not those things are true, and when they are, apply them to our lives. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the congregation here, for the elders, for the deacons, and all who continue to work in Thy vineyard. We're especially thankful at this time for Jeremy and the work that he does in coordinating our classes here at GSOP. We pray, Father, that Thou would continue to give him long life in service to Thee. Heavenly Father, may we always put Thee first in our lives and seek to bring honor and glory unto Thee with all that we do, with all that we learn, and help us to learn as much as we can throughout this series of lessons. In Jesus' holy name we do pray. Amen.
Amen. All right. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Jeremy. I wanted to begin by congratulating him. Just last week, he successfully defended his master's thesis, and I was blessed to be a part of that panel. And I know what work goes into a project like that, and did a good job writing on a really tough subject. It's actually related to one of the verses that we'll be looking at in 2 Timothy. And so when we get there, I'll just ask you if you would. I love these two letters. I think that sometimes when we think about 1 and 2 Timothy, we perhaps take a more thematic approach. When you think about these two letters, what topics stand out to you? What most sermons we hear about 1 or 2 Timothy are on the topic of what? Would you say? Church leadership,
right?
1 Timothy chapter 3, and if we were looking at Titus, it's going to be hard for me not to talk about Titus, because typically when we talk about the letters to Timothy, we talk about Titus, and so I'll have to make a few allusions as we go. But we think about church leadership, maybe we think about the nature of Scripture. You know, the one verse in all the New Testament uses the word theopneustos in Greek, which we translate inspired, or God breathed, or breathed out. I think it's how the ESV renders 2 Timothy 3, verse 16. All Scripture is inspired and profitable. We think about the nature of Scripture. Perhaps we think about false teaching. You know, Timothy is charged as a young preacher in Ephesus to hold on to the truth and stand for what's right. So my point is, as with any book, I'm guilty at times of sort of cherry-picking themes from these letters and maybe not thinking about what these letters have to say as a whole. I'm sure you've heard it said that Every text without a context is a pretext for making it say what we want it to say. And so part of my goal over the next couple of days, and by the way, thank you for giving up time to study God's Word. It's such an encouragement to me. I've taught for the Georgia School of Preaching before, but at the Warner Robins campus, and so it's great to be in Adairsville, and I just really appreciate the sacrifices that you've made to be here. I was mentioning earlier, I wrapped up a gospel meeting last night in West Tennessee, and it was such an encouraging week. The grandson of one of the elders there was baptized on Tuesday night, and several were restored, and it was just encouraging to spend time and study. And although we weren't looking at these two letters, I'm really hoping that this can be a time of discussion. I have a vested interest in these two letters selfishly for two reasons. To be honest with you, I've never taught a class at Free Hardeman on these specific letters, and so this has been fun to think about, get ready for. But I am writing a commentary for the Truth for Today series. Maybe you've seen that set before, some great authors in that, on the three letters, 1st, 2nd Timothy, and Titus. And I'm embarrassed to say I'm in the third year of writing that, just because there's so much there. My friend David Light just finished the John commentary, and I've been helping proof that, and it's at 667 pages on 21 chapters. And I'm hoping that with just 10 chapters between 1st and 2nd Timothy, maybe my commentary could be a lot shorter and a lot cheaper in the long run. Sellers Crane, you know, wrote the one on Matthew, and he wrote so much, it's in two volumes, the same with the one on Acts and several others. So I'm hoping to have a one volume edition of that. And in February, Lord willing, February 4th through 8th, our lectureship at Free Hardeman is on 1st, 2nd Timothy and Titus. And so our committee, we've divvied up 160 lectures from these two letters and assigned those. And so we get together and have a retreat every fall and work through those texts and think about topics and studies. And so those two efforts have really sort of prompted me to think more about these letters along with Titus, which again, I'll try to not talk about Titus too much in our time. But here's what I'm thinking we might try to do. I'd like tonight to just camp out on the context of these two letters. And I know that sometimes context can be speculative, but what I'm going to try to do is tie this to three specific realities. We're going to talk about history. We know a lot about the writer of these two letters. He writes 13 letters in the New Testament. The first 12 chapters of Acts are primarily about the Apostle Peter. In Acts 13, Saul becomes Paul, and the rest of Acts, through chapter 28, is really about Paul's journeys and God working through Paul. And so we know some things about the writer. We know some things about the recipient. One of the things we'll note, I've got this notebook, and my notes are not all going to be on the slides because for every verse of these letters, I'm using my commentary stuff, and so I'm going to be reading out of the New American Standard, but referring to my own translation, and I've got a page for each verse. And so what I'd like for us to do is think about Timothy as a recipient, and my point there was to say, as we talk about some of the Greek, I'm not going to bore us with a bunch of that, but and Jeremy, this came up, I think, when we were talking about your thesis even. Every reference, every pronoun, and every verb, you know, in Greek, verbs have numbers, so you know if they're singular or plural, you know if they're first, second, or third person. It's clear that the recipient, the primary recipient of these two letters was Timothy. Now, I do think there's a broader application for the Christians he's serving in Ephesus. Paul, at the very beginning of 1 Timothy, makes reference to that. And it's interesting to think about Ephesus because Paul and John have deep connections there. Paul spends 3 years in Ephesus in Acts 19. And I guess other than Corinth, where Paul spends a year and a half in Acts 18, Paul's probably closer to the Christians at Ephesus. You might argue Antioch or Jerusalem. So we're going to talk about the history. We're going to talk about the literary context. In other words, there's a way to read a letter. If you think about it, it's kind of interesting that 21 of the 27 books in the New Testament our letters. Now, we're going to exclude the gospel accounts and Acts, and we're going to put Revelation, even though Revelation includes seven letters in Revelation 2 and 3, it's also prophecy and apocalypse. So there's something unique about a letter. It's sort of like listening in on one end of a phone call, and we have to think about what was happening in Ephesus and why Paul wrote what he wrote to Timothy. But the other key factor here, and I want to really start with this, is the theological context. And that just simply reminds us that this isn't just a letter from Paul to Timothy. This is God's word. And as Paul writes this, as God moves him to write this, this is one of several letters that is very personal. 2 Timothy, other than Romans, is probably my favorite letter in the whole Pauline corpus, because, and I'm going to make allusion to this several times over the next couple of days, but you think about the fact that it seems that Paul's life is about over. I would order these three letters, 1 Timothy, Titus, and then 2 Timothy. And when you get to 2 Timothy chapter 4, it's almost like we're reading Paul's last words, at least that are included in Scripture. And what's he focused on? I know some of you perhaps have been involved in jail ministry, and you know, Jesus reminds us of that opportunity in Matthew 25, 31 through 46, when he says, you know, we visit the prisoner, we give food to the hungry, drink to the thirsty, we clothe the naked, we visit the sick. I find that a lot of people in prison want to talk about why they're in prison and maybe how they've been wrongly accused and what they're going to do when they get out. Paul has every opportunity at the end of 2 Timothy to talk about himself and to talk about what he wants to do and maybe dreams that weren't fulfilled. But what's he focused on?
I fought the good fight.
He's focused on his ministry, the work of God, and the preservation of the truth. He's focused on what's yet to come. And, you know, second to our Lord, who clearly from the cross and even in Acts 1, verses 9 through 11, as he ascends into heaven, he's focusing on everyone else, on God's work, on the blessing of God's work to everyone else. He just learned something about the heart of Paul, and more importantly, the heart of God. So we're going to look at those contexts tonight and get into 1 Timothy. And then I tried to just think about giving every chapter, they're not all the same length, giving every chapter time, about an hour apiece if everything works out according to plan. We'll, of course, take breaks in there now and then, but I really want us to just study the Word. There's a time for commentary. There's a time for chasing rabbits, if you will. I've got some students who love to, you know, get me off on a tangent, and I might do that. I hope not. But what I want this to be is just a time of Bible study and discussion. I've got some things I want to share with you, but if you have an observation or a question, please don't hesitate to share that. So in terms of our method, we're going to take a verse-by-verse approach. We are going to occasionally look at the text with an eye towards both interpretation and application. I've already mentioned the three contexts that we're going to try to continually call ourselves back to. And we are going to think about certain themes that get a lot of attention in these letters. Church leadership, worship, especially 1 Timothy 2, verses 8 through 15, where it's probably the passage in the New Testament other than Ephesians 5, 22 through 25, or 1 Corinthians 11, 3 through 16, or 14, 33 through 36, where the most is said about the relationship of men and women in the assembly. But that's not all Paul talks about in that chapter. He also talks about prayer. 1 Timothy 5 is a chapter we often ignore. Paul, in writing to Timothy, actually describes who qualifies as a widow to be cared for by the church. And we're going to wrestle with that. Should we still require that widow that's cared for by the church not have remarried, be over 60 years old? There are some things that Paul mentions there that sometimes sort of get swept under the rug compared to the qualifications of elders and deacons in 1 Timothy 3. And so we'll talk about that. And of course, 2 Timothy 3:16 is this book that the Warren Center is putting out next month, Lord willing. The whole first chapter is on inspiration. And you've got to start at 2 Timothy 3:16 because That's the clearest statement about the nature of Scripture in all the New Testament. I work with a fellow, Dr. Justin Rogers, who got his PhD from Hebrew Union in the Old Testament. And so we like to do a yin and yang thing, the sweet and sour thing. I won't tell you who the sour guy is, but he does the Old Testament stuff, and I do the New Testament stuff. And the really weird thing is, about the same time the Warren Center said, hey, let's do a book, Gospel Advocate said, let's do a book. And so Justin and I have been writing this thing. He's writing the Old Testament part, and I'm writing the New Testament part. And it's coming out around Christmas. And so if you've got a really big stocking, no, I just think it's really weird to be writing two books on the same topic. But there's so much to be said about inspiration that it's really easy to say what God's Word includes. So I know that every class is different, every teacher is different, every format is different. But I'm a student of the Word. I love to study the Bible. Every time I read it, I learn something new. I've got some great grad students who ask some great questions, but I get tougher questions at home from my kids in our nightly devos. I'll just tell you one, and we'll get into the study here. A few weeks ago, we were studying Matthew 24. That's a tough chapter, you know, where Jesus is talking about the last days, and it's parallel to Mark 13 and Luke 21. And obviously, Jesus is talking about the fall of Jerusalem, but he's also looking forward, especially in Matthew 24, to his return. And you'll recall on that occasion how Jesus says that in heaven, there's no marrying nor giving in marriage. Well, my 10, almost 11, she turns 11 August 31st, 11-year-old daughter is already smarter than I am. She's already corrected my grammar. She's like her mom. And so she's asking some really tough questions, and she's stumped by this there's no marriage in heaven thing. And she's grilling us, and she says, so, Dad, are you saying that you and Mom won't be married in heaven? What's that going to mean to our family? And she's just, I mean, relentless. And my 8-year-old son just looks at her, and when she says, you mean there's no marriage in heaven? He said, yep, only in the other place. There's a smart little kid. He's taking after his daddy, and he's praying for us. We'll want to do a better job. So my point is that sometimes questions are good, and we'll see how the answers are as we work through this together. So here's what I'd like for us to do. I'd like for us to start, and we'll take just a little time. How often do y'all usually take breaks? About every 30 minutes? I'm just kidding. About one. You take one or two usually for a 3-hour thing.
We usually just take one at the top of the hour.
Okay, perfect. Well, if you're ready for a break, just tell me. We'll take a break. Sometimes I get bloviating and the hot air builds up. Get too excited. We're going to start by thinking about Paul for just a little while, and you might wonder, wait a second, I thought we're talking about 1 and 2 Timothy. I want to just throw some things out. I've got some slides, and by the way, anything you see on these slides, I will pass on to Jeremy, and you guys are welcome to. If it's not, you know, the way I feel about this is if there's something you find useful in the material we're sharing, I'm not copywriting this. This is God's Word. It's something I think we all want to use to help others and help ourselves, and so feel free to use this. I think that when we think about the Apostle Paul, I like to think about two words, because part of what makes this difficult is there's only one man, although he's a complex man, right? In Acts 26, when he stands before King Agrippa, and for the third time in Acts, which I think Brother Dan taught in Acts the last time there was a class, for the third time in Acts, we see the story of Paul meeting Jesus. Acts 9, it happens. Acts 22, he tells it before King Agrippa. And you might recall that in Acts 26, verses 4 through 11, he tells the story of what it used to be in Judaism. Verses 12 through 18, what it was like to encounter the Lord. And then verses 19 through 23, before Festus so rudely interrupts him in verse 24, Paul talks about his life after encountering Jesus. So even though Paul's one man, he's a complex individual. There's a lot of questions about Paul, and there's a handout in your folder that I'm not going to read through with you. It should be about 6 or 7 pages long. It's just a brief introduction to Paul. I'm just going to flash through some things. But that one man wrote 13 letters by God's inspiration. Now, in ancient times, at least in the Eastern world, they thought he wrote Hebrews. And so in some manuscripts, they would credit 14 letters to the Apostle Paul and group Hebrews in there with that. I don't know who wrote Hebrews, Origen said, God only knows, and I agree with Origen on that. I know Timothy didn't write it because he's greeted at the end of the letter. It appears that the writer knows Timothy well. He writes to encourage those Christians. My point is, I personally don't know if it was Paul or not, but if it is Paul who writes Hebrews, his style is so different in Hebrews than what we see in all the other letters. He doesn't identify himself. The vocabulary is different. It's not the typical form. Hebrews starts like a sermon and ends like a letter. It's sort of the opposite of James, starts like a letter, ends like a sermon. So I would say that I don't know who wrote Hebrews, but it's probably not Paul. So when you think about one man writing 13 letters, I think about two words. The first word is coherence. Sorry, my handwriting's sloppy, but I'm a Greek teacher. What do you expect, right? And then the other word is contingency. The reason I think about the words coherence and contingency, even though the situations vary in these 13 letters, for example, Paul writes two letters to churches he had never visited in person, Rome and Colossians. He had never visited either of those places. But then he writes letters to the Philippian brethren, and he spends all of chapter 4 talking about how thankful he is for them and how much they have in common. He writes letters to the Galatians. He had just visited southern Galatia, the cities of Lystra and Iconium and Derbe and Antioch in Acts 13 and 14. So, but even though there are variables that are always changing, that's the contingency. That's the situational context of any given letter. Meaning, that person or group of people, they have their own setting, they have their own problems, they have their own experience. In light of all of that change, all of those variables, there is still something that is constant throughout every letter Paul writes. And that is the conviction that Jesus Christ is Lord, and that encountering the Lord on the road to Damascus and being baptized to Ananias in Damascus changed Paul's life and gave him a mission. And you see the heart of Paul the missionary in every letter he writes. And so part of what we struggle with is letting Romans be Romans and Galatians be Galatians and 1 and 2 Thessalonians being 1 and 2 Thessalonians, etc., while also respecting the fact that one God wrote all 13 letters through one man. And so there's consistency in the message. In the handout, for example, I talk about the way these letters are categorized. There are four letters that Paul writes that talk more about salvation questions than any other letters. Romans, Galatians, 1 and 2 Corinthians. Two letters, Paul talks a lot about the return of Jesus, because it seems those Thessalonian Christians were struggling with the death of their loved ones and had questions, and apparently somebody was making some false claims, and Paul has to respond to that in 2 Thessalonians. Then, it's interesting, we have really five prison epistles, but we only count four. You know, we talk about Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon as jailmen or prison epistles, but I would add 2 Timothy to that. Even though we put 2 Timothy in a different category, since the 19th century, what have people called categorically 1st, 2nd Timothy, and Titus? The what epistles?
Pastoral.
Yeah, the pastoral epistles. And that's a bit confusing because the word pastor is literally a shepherd. It's one of the synonyms, you know, in Ephesians 4, 11 through 16, Paul talks about how there are various offices in the church, apostles and prophets. And he gets down, he mentions evangelists, and then he says pastors and teachers. I think he's talking about elders there, those who, according to 1 Timothy 3, are apt to teach. So what's interesting, though, about this idea of a pastor is that that language would describe Peter more accurately than it would Paul, because Peter says in 1 Peter 5, you know, he's an elder, a fellow elder until the chief shepherd appears, 1 Peter 5, 4. So he's not an elder, but he is shepherding young Timothy. I say young. Timothy's probably been ministering for 20 years when he gets this letter. And young Titus, Timothy at Ephesus, Titus on the island of Crete. They both look to Paul as a mentor. Here's the thing about labeling these letters pastoral epistles. Every letter Paul writes, in some ways, is pastoral, because he's being viewed as an apostle with authority, who's respected, and there is coherence in the message, even though the situation is always changing. And something that
is you know, I'm just curious if you could maybe shed some light on the scholarly notion and objective evidence that the letters 1st and 2nd Timothy, not necessarily Titus, are epigraphical. In other words, they were written by others, not necessarily Paul. You keep saying 13 letters by Paul or God through one man.
Right.
But there's been support, at least what I've come across, where there's been argument saying, no, he didn't write those, that others wrote on his behalf.
Yeah, they're the most attacked letters of Paul, other than Ephesians and maybe 2 Thessalonians. And we are going to talk about authorship. That's on my...
I appreciate
so,
that.
So, yeah.
That would...
The big question is...
Cloudy, you
know. Yeah. I'll just hint at it. We'll come back to it after we eat something. But the oldest textual witness to the Pauline epistles is a document from around the year 200. It's a papyrus manuscript, P46. And it includes 10 of Paul's 13 letters. Guess which three it doesn't include?
Timothy, 1st and 2nd, and Titus.
Exactly. And so our oldest witness to the Pauline letters doesn't include these three. So externally, people question the origin of these letters because it's not in that manuscript. And there are some internal questions as well. So what I'm planning on doing is showing you all the options. And I'm just going to humbly suggest that it might take more faith to believe in the fragmentary hypothesis that basically Timothy was put together, 1st and 2nd Timothy was put together by somebody who collected a bunch of post-it notes and basically made a quilt, that takes as much or more faith than thinking it's Paul. We're going to deal with vocabulary questions and theme questions, and so we'll take some time on that. That's a great question.
I mean, there's even been 330 words that have been identified as being differently written, differently spoken, that may not even be
a I want to talk about those words specifically and talk about why the vocabulary argument's a tricky thing either way you go.
Awesome.
Yes, sir.
We have to keep in mind to study Acts is important. Who the likely author is. All in all, it still is part of the Word of God. I think that's the most important thing.
It is.
Regardless of who thinks who or what.
Well, that's right. And what I'm interested in doing as a person of faith is trusting the Word of God and building my faith on it, but also being able to step out to the public square and have a conversation with someone who doesn't believe that. And, you know, in the Google world, all it takes is a quick search to see that some people don't believe Paul wrote these letters. And I just don't want, you know, we're going to have to walk by faith and not by sight, but I don't want that to immediately kill the conversation. You know, if we were to say, well, we have the congregation here recognized two new elders last week. We recently did that at Estes and Henderson. And they say, well, where'd you get that newfangled idea? Now, I could say Philippians 1:1 or Acts, but I might say 1 Timothy 3 and Titus 1, and they say, well, Paul didn't write that. And I say, what you talking about? You know, but, and so, you're right. And as a Christian, that's a conviction that I want to start with. But I want to help other people who might approach this question from an intellectual or experiential side, be able to see that we walk by faith, but there's evidence for why we walk by faith. And I think, you know, one quick thing, I'll get back to this. I mentioned the 13 letters. Do you know how the letters of Paul found the order that they're in our New Testament, the English New Testament? Our kids, you know, like singing the books of the New Testament. Romans, Galatians, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, that all the way down through Titus and Philemon, how they came to be in that order. It's not the order Paul likely wrote them in, and they're not sorted by content. There's two criteria, longest to shortest, churches to individuals. Have you noticed that 1st, 2nd Timothy, Titus, and Philemon are at the end of that group? Well, it's because traditionally, These are letters that are addressed to individuals. While Romans, Galatians, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Philippians, Colossians, Ephesians, Philemon, but 1st and 2nd Thessalonians are congregation letters. So Romans is the longest letter to a congregation. 1st Timothy is the longest letter to an individual. So churches to individuals, longest to shortest. Now, there are a few places where that varies. For example, we keep 1st and 2nd Corinthians together, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians together, 1st and 2nd Timothy together. But my point is, I have no problem with that order. I don't want to change the song. But the ordering of those books is not, they're not ordered by the order in which they're written or their content. And so the reason 1st, 2nd Timothy, and Titus appear where they appear in the list of Paul's letters in our English Bibles is length and who they're addressed to. Philemon is last, obviously, because it could probably fit on a single sheet of papyrus or parchment, whatever, if they're using plant material or animal material to write those original copies on. What I'd like to do is just talk about the things related to Paul that I think impact these two letters the most, because we could have a whole class on the life of Paul, and I would love that, but it's not really the primary focus here. I am convinced through historical, textual, literary evidence that Paul is the author of these two letters. P.N. Harrison wrote a book that is sort of popular out there in the world, suggesting that this is sort of something that a redactor wove into one letter. He found some things that were genuine of Paul, and he wrote it in a way that it would address questions in his contemporary context that Paul never addressed. That's the theory that even in scholarly circles, I'm a member of a couple of organizations that they meet annually. It's completely academic. And a lot of those people reject these three letters. And I don't. I believe Paul writes them. So let's talk a little bit. We can talk about his family, his name, his trade, his education, his conversion, his marital status, his suffering, his prison time, his thorn in the flesh, and his death. Of these 10, we're going to be selective and just talk about the ones that I think impact 1st and 2nd Timothy the most. Obviously, family language is central in the New Testament. Remember in Mark 3, first of all, Jesus has a family. He has 4 younger brothers and at least 2 younger sisters. They're named, the brothers are named, in Matthew 13, verse 55, and Mark 6, verse 3, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas. We're told in John 7, verse 5, those brothers don't believe in Jesus, but they do show up post-resurrection in Acts 1, verse 14. It's actually the last time the mother of Jesus shows up in the New Testament, in Acts 1, verse 14. So Jesus has a physical family, and you recall that in Mark 3, that occasion when Jesus is in a crowded house and his family comes and they think he's in trouble, and someone comes to Jesus and they say, Lord, your mother and brothers, some manuscripts say your sisters, because they are mentioned in Luke, are outside, and Jesus looks around at that circle around him and says, you are my mother and sisters and brothers. What he's saying there is, family gets redefined in the New Testament. Matthew 10, 34 through 39, Jesus says, don't think that I came to bring peace, but a sword. And he talks about families being divided. Obviously, God is not interested in dividing families, because God established the family in Genesis 2. But I think what Jesus is saying is, sometimes faith causes families to break apart, tragically. That was not Timothy's experience. What do we learn about Timothy's family in 2 Timothy 3:15? What do we learn about his grandmother and mother?
They trained him up.
They trained him the fear of the Lord. And he had been taught the Holy Scriptures. That's the language Paul uses in 2 Timothy 3:15, right before he talks about inspiration. Very next verse. So even though Paul uses both paternal and maternal language, mother and father language, in these letters, and you have that kinship connection that's clear here. We do know some things about Paul's family, about his mom and his dad, and about his nephew who saves his life in Acts on one occasion when there's an assassination attempt. You might recall how 200 soldiers and 70 horsemen took Paul under the cover of darkness from Jerusalem to a little town called Caesarea Maritime to get him out of there because there was a plot on his life. But I think it's pretty clear that even though Paul has family, it's hard to get closer to Paul than Timothy. I mean, the language he uses to describe Timothy as his son in the faith, for example. And we see other relationships like that. We often overlook the relationship that Peter has with John Mark. In Acts 12, you know, Mary, the mother of John Mark, is hosting the church in her home. And you see a connection already between Peter and John Mark there. But over in 1 Peter 5:13, Peter basically refers to John Mark in the same way that Paul refers to Timothy. This is a side thing, but sometimes as a preacher, I like to talk about how there are three people you need in your life. You need a Paul, you need a Timothy, and you need a Barnabas. And I'm not saying go out and find somebody named Barnabas. That might be hard, even though my kids have weird names. You never know. What I mean is, you need somebody who can be a mentor, a Paul, a teacher, someone you can go to, that you respect, that you can trust, that you can ask questions of, and get counsel from. You need a Timothy, somebody you can teach, who can you can be a mentor to. Sometimes you can learn a lot more from teaching than you ever will from studying, just because there's live ammo. People can ask questions, right? You don't talk about, you know, studied Greek for years, and then I started teaching it, and I realized, uh-oh, they're asking questions. You know, and sometimes as a teacher, it's catch me if you can. I'm going to stay 10 pages ahead and see who can catch me. But, you know, it can be intimidating and challenging when people ask those gotcha questions, right? So you need a Paul, somebody you can look to as a teacher. You need a Timothy, somebody you can teach. And you need a Barnabas, somebody who can just be there to encourage you. We all need that. You know, we all need somebody. And I think you really see, in a strange way, even though Paul's the one, God through Paul is the one writing these two letters. You see in a strange way that this is a reciprocating relationship. Paul is mentoring Timothy, but as Paul pours out his heart in 2 Timothy, you really see what Timothy means to Paul. Not only in visiting him when he's in prison in Rome and begging him to come before winter, at least in Titus, there we go again. But even in the way he talks about the future. You know, we had a camp at Free Harden a few weeks ago, it feels like a few years ago, the Horizons camp, we had 1,200 kids. And I knew the future was bright in the Lord, the boy. Being around some of those young men and women and seeing their faith and knowing what they are trying to do, so encouraging. So I think you see that. Obviously, you see Paul make reference to his conversion. I think we could talk about any of these, but the two that, maybe the three in the second column that are most important here, suffering, prison time, and death. Suffering is not just something Paul experiences, it's a part of his ministry. I mean, let's just imagine, I promise we're going to get to 1 Timothy 1 in just a little while, but let's just imagine that the elders over here across the parking lot, they're going to invite in a special speaker in 2 weeks to talk about suffering. And they're going to let the congregation choose, which is kind of interesting to think about. The first person, he's 24. He's just finished his PhD in psychology, and he wrote his dissertation on human suffering. He's a Christian, and he studied this thoroughly, and he knows the facts, and he knows the methods, and he knows the theory. The second option is a man who just turned 81. He's a survivor of cancer. He's a veteran. He lost his wife. He's lost a daughter, and yet he's maintained his faith. I don't know about you, but I'd rather hear that guy speak than the young PhD. Because there's wisdom. Wisdom is not just knowledge, it's knowledge applied. And when Paul walked into the room,
or limped into the room. You know, he alludes in 2 Corinthians to the fact that he's not a very good public speaker, but I wonder, I don't know if the when he talks about the bearing the marks of Christ in Galatians 6, I've often wondered what those are. Is that related to the thorn in the flesh? Do you have a vision problem? I don't know. But I wonder, I mean, when you read his list of suffering in 2 Corinthians 11, the chapter before he talks about the thorn in the flesh, if you've been beaten with rods and imprisoned and shipwrecked and stoned and left for dead, just reading what happens to him in Acts, you think there are some scars there? I think people have heard that story. I mean, early on in Paul's ministry, they're talking about, this is the guy who used to help kill Christians. And now they're talking about, this is the guy who's almost died for the faith again and again and again. I just want to recommend that in these letters, we see that Paul's suffering is not extra. It is central to his ministry. It supports what it is he's saying. Prison time. Boy, we learned something about Paul at the end of Acts 28 when he's in his own room quarters for 2 years under house arrest preaching the kingdom. We learned something in Philippians when Paul's incarcerated. It's, you know, the context of I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me in Philippians 4:13 is prison. That's jail now. And then you read 2 Timothy, and I mean, he's the model citizen. He's the model prisoner. He's the model Christian. And finally, we don't know how Paul dies for sure, but there's strong tradition that both Paul and Peter, in that order, die in Rome at the hands of a crazy emperor named Nero who reigns from 54 to 68 AD. He's such a bad guy that when he dies, there's a civil war, and eventually Vespasian rises to power in Rome. Nero is the nephew of the previous emperor named Claudius, who was also assassinated. You've got a good insurance if you're elected emperor. But Nero's first five years of his reign were really good. Then he got paranoid. He executed his own mother. It makes the stuff Henry VIII did look like kindergarten. He is famous for what the Fox's Book of Martyrs has to say, and some of that's probably mythological, about how he would use Christians as torches in his gardens, and how he would allow wild animals to, this is pretty graphic, but to kill and destroy pregnant Christian women. Just an awful guy. And if half of that's true, you just get there's actually a biography of Nero and several other emperors written by a first century historian named Suetonius. He wrote a book titled The 12 Caesars. And I'll just say this. It makes the scandals of modern day Washington, as bad as they are, look mild, because the behavior is as carnal and as violent and sadistic as you could imagine. And so my point is, we're not sure how Paul dies, but we know why Paul dies, and we know what he stood for as he faced death. And I personally believe in 2 Timothy is about as close to Paul's last will and testament as we can get. And so there is a place, I think, when you read these contingent letters, to think about a man whose thinking was shaped by his training under Gamaliel in Judaism. He's the star student. Hebrew of Hebrews, circumcised the eighth day, tribe of Benjamin. But also one who had encountered Jesus, and because of that, as an apostle. What does it mean to be an apostle? And he uses that in the very first verse of 1 Timothy. Three things: eyewitness of the resurrected Jesus, sent out to preach with Jesus' authority, empowered with the apostolic measure of the Holy Spirit. The word apostolos is a derivative of the verb apostello. That means I send out. So an apostle is one sent out to preach with Jesus' authority, full measure of the Holy Spirit. But he's also a missionary. And so a lot of the material that I've given you on Paul is included, and I've just got slides on Paul, and I'll be glad to pass these on. Let me show you one thing, and then we'll get to 1 Timothy in particular. I love comparing the three stories of
Paul's encounter with Jesus in Acts 9, Acts 22, and Acts 26. And the things that are underlined are where Paul gives us a little bit more detail or something that's, it's not contradictory, but it's just it just illuminates our understanding. And so notice the consistency. Paul's going to Damascus on the authority of the priests to imprison Christians. He doesn't mention time in Acts 9. Luke doesn't tell us the story, but it's about noon or midday when the bright light shines. He hears a voice. He does tell us before Agrippa that he hears a voice in Hebrew or Aramaic. Could be either. They look the same, but the way they use the article and point vowels is a little bit different. We have a record of what those around him were experiencing, what Paul asked Ananias' struggle to understand what it is that he is to do, but eventually how Paul is baptized, and from the very beginning of the ministry, he is an apostle to the Gentiles. And we see Peter make that transition after his Cornelius vision in Acts 10, but we also see Paul there in Acts 15, and he's there even before Caesar, twice, it appears. And part of the question that we'll get to with authorship is, how many times was Paul in prison in Rome? It's sort of popular to say once, because if we believe Paul wrote these letters, and I believe he did, this has to happen after Acts is over. And we'll talk about the implications of that. But there's a lot we could say about Paul. My point is, I'm going to give God the credit, but contextually, I think God wants us to see who wrote it, why he wrote it, when he wrote it, who he wrote it to, and what it's about. I teach a really boring class at Fried Hardeman called Critical Introduction to the New Testament. And we talk about every book in 16 weeks, and those are the questions we ask. Who wrote it? When did they write it? Why did they write it? Who did they write it to? What's it about? And somebody, you know, might say, well, who cares? Well, that's a good question. But I think about James 3:1, let not many of you be teachers, my brethren, knowing you will incur a stricter judgment. I think if we're going to be teachers, if we're going to be equippers, to use Ephesians 4:11's language, we need to do our best to be able to get an answer and still walk by faith, clearly, but to be equipped to the best of our ability to understand, especially in the letter where we're only seeing one side of the conversation. We're not getting anything from the reader. Timothy doesn't write anything, right? That picture, yes, sir.
Well, if you don't know who wrote it, who you wrote it to, why did you write it, what was said, then how in the world, I mean, that's part of the learning curve, I say, in being able to convey those things to people that you're studying with, if you're trying to teach them the gospel, because it keeps, that helps you keep things and helps them keep things in context and gives you better understanding, you know?
And that you can apply the same thing with the scientific method or in the legal realm, you know, sure, with regard to constitutional law. Everything has a context.
Right.
It'd be really difficult to do any job to investigate. I would imagine it'd be very difficult without being able to consider
the intent,
contextual questions.
Right. Like, yeah, you know, sometimes you think things mean certain things in the legal realm, but you have to sometimes look at the intent of that particular law. You know. Yeah.
Absolutely. Any other discussion, questions, comments? I'm going to move away from Paul in particular and actually get to what we're going to be talking about. I just wanted to sort of set the stage for that. We've been going about an hour. Does that mean we need to take a break? Let's take a break, and we'll come back. And I don't know how long we break.
You're in charge, so we don't have much material.
Let's take. Y'all usually take about 10 minutes. Is that too long?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay. Let's take about 10 minutes, and we'll get up the first 10 minutes.